I'm Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Exercise your imagination. This week, Merwin Gerard's study of a man pursued. Dead Man's Tale. Starring George Maharis. Craig Stevens. And Charles McGraw. In Elliot Lewis's production of The Zero Hour. Our story this week is a case for rebuttal to the old adage, dead men tell no tales. It's the story of Carl Brooks, a young man, a practicing lawyer, one of two junior district attorneys under political zealot Lloyd Mercer. It will be Carl Brooks's misfortune to be asked to perform a favor by and for his mentor. Misfortune that begins with murder and proliferates over a life reborn and a span of 4 years' time. His initial chance discovery and the subsequent smoldering guilt will prove to be the driving catalytic force to spirit him back to the scene of the crime. A dead man knows the truth. And for Carl Brooks, a mission of repentance and search for that truth will lead him to peel back the layers of deceit and uncover what we can only call Dead Man's Tale. Our story begins after this word. Picture this. Dusk of a late autumn day in a seemingly typical Midwestern city of 300,000. In the office of District Attorney Lloyd Mercer, the day's work is winding to a close. The secretary has gone home, leaving two young men to their game of darts in the outer office.
Bullseye! How about that shot, Barry?
No good, Carl. You stepped over the line.
Now, come on, Barry. You're not going to take 100 points from me over an imaginary line, are you?
Carl Brooks and Barry Wilson, both 24 years old, close friends and Lloyd Mercer's junior DAs.
Gentlemen, who's winning?
You are, Chief, if the latest figures in the polls are right.
Yes, they were very encouraging. Come to the office.
Encouraging? 57% for you, 36% for all the other candidates combined, 7% undecided. And less than a week to go, you're a shoo-in for another term.
I never count votes until election night. Which one of you can spare me a small favor this evening? I have to get home and change for that rally.
Well, I still have some work on the Bostwick brief, and you'll need it first thing tomorrow.
Right. And you've also got a family awaiting dinner.
Which, by the process of elimination, leaves the bachelor with a clear desk. Okay, what can I do for you, Chief?
Barry, would you close the door on your way up?
Oh, sure thing.
Carl, I want you to go to the Delta Hotel and pick up an attaché case for me. The man's name is Robert Henley. He'll be expecting you. He's in room 515. And when you get it, bring it straight to me at election headquarters. I'll need those documents tonight before the rally. Now, I'm off with you.
Yes, sir. Good luck tonight, Mr. Mercer.
What could go wrong? I'm addressing our 57%.
I left the office and took a cab to the Delta Hotel. The desk clerk waved as I walked by, and I told the elevator man, fifth floor. The door to room 515 was, oddly, not quite closed. Mr. Henley? It's Carl Brooks from Lloyd Mercer's office. Mr. Henley? Mr. Henley? Hey. What? Oh, my God. Hello, main desk. Get me the food.
Cute.
What?
But not cute enough.
Maharis, what are you doing here?
No need to ask what you're doing, is there? Calling the Red Cross, maybe? Donating blood?
This man's dead.
Oh, that's very good, Counselor. Very good indeed. I'll take that money now.
What?
Come on, come on. It's too late for games. You're out of your league, sonny.
What are you talking about? You think I killed him?
Fancy that. Tell you what, just hand over the cash and I'll forget I saw you here. You can run and maybe you can beat the murder rap.
Now, wait a minute. This is insane.
Not insane, just stupid. But then you couldn't know I make it a habit to keep my eye on my investments.
Your investments? Look, I don't have any idea what you're talking about, Ferris, but I'm going...
You're not going to do anything or go anywhere until you cough up that 150 grand.
150? Get out of my way, Ferris.
Sorry. The money, Brooks. Hand it over or I'll... Get...
Election headquarters.
Lloyd Mercer, please. It's urgent.
Carl?
Sir?
You're lucky I'm still here, boy. Where are you? What's the matter?
Everything's the matter. Robert Henley is dead.
What? I'm sorry, Carl. I couldn't hear you. What did you say?
Robert Henley. He's dead.
What?
I went up to his room and found him on the floor. His throat. It was cut from ear to ear.
What about the attaché case?
Well, it was still handcuffed to his wrist, but it was broken open and it was empty.
Empty?
There's all $150,000 worth of documents. Mr. D.A., are you there?
You'd better get over here right away, Carl.
Joe Ferris was there. He saw me in the room. He thinks I killed Henley.
Well, that's the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard.
He said there was money involved.
Where is he now?
Well, Ferris? He's still up there. I don't know. I don't plan to be around when he comes to. I had to hit him to get out.
Come over to headquarters. I have to see you.
Well, everyone else has. Ferris... The desk clerk, the elevator man, my fingerprints. They're all over that room.
Carl, I'll explain, but not over the phone.
Well, just explain two things to me. $150,000 and one dead man.
You get over here, Brooks. Now. Right now.
Mercer? Mercer! Taxi! Taxi!
Carl! Hey, Carl, where are you going? The chief told me to pick you up and... Carl!
The airport. And move.
Carl!
It wasn't logical. And it wasn't intelligent. It was sheer, blind panic that made me take the first westbound plane out of town. After all, I was innocent, regardless of how it looked. But it looked like a setup, with me, dead center in the frame. When the plane landed, I bought a hometown paper. The story of Henley's murder was all over the front page. Carl Brooks was a wanted man. I dumped the paper in the trash can and moved on, and on, from town to town. The days ran into weeks and in months. I never read anything more or heard about it. I didn't want to know. Guilt is not always something that can be determined in a court of law. I had to establish a new life if I was to survive, beginning with a new name, Charles Barrows. A 3-day construction job brought me into a small central town in California, the town of Coulter. I stayed 4 years, growing with the town. I enrolled in a real estate school where I met Jenny Duncan. We studied together. And in 4 years, our friendship blossomed into something far greater.
Be right there, Jen.
How's my land bearing doing today?
Fine, let's go.
Where?
Anywhere, just drive somewhere.
All right. Rough day at the office? You sure had me fooled, Charles Barrows.
What? What do you mean?
Honey, all I meant was you're terribly cranky today.
Oh. I'm sorry, Jenny. I didn't mean to take it out on you. I mean, that's the last thing I want to do, believe me. Let's go to the lake. We've always been able to say what we mean there.
All right.
See the circle the pebble makes in the water? I bet you can't throw one inside it.
I thought we came here to say what we meant. What is it, Charles?
Oh. Well, a man came in today. He was interested in a piece of property over by Golden Valley. I was showing him the brochure when he said he thought he'd seen me somewhere before.
Well, that is possible. Coulter isn't San Francisco.
He just moved here from the Midwest.
He probably thought you were someone else.
Like Carl Brooks.
Who? Charles, what are you not telling me?
Jenny, do you know how much I love you? I mean, how much you mean to me? 4 years ago, a man was killed in the town I grew up in. Carl Brooks worked for the district attorney at the time. He found the body, but that's all he did. But it was somehow made to look like he was a suspect, the prime suspect.
What happened to him?
Well, he disappeared.
And you have the same color hair, right?
We're one and the same.
I don't believe it.
Well, it's true. And if it weren't, well, I'd have proposed marriage a long time ago.
Charles.
My conscience wouldn't allow me to ask. I mean, I'd give up anything for you, Jenny. I would. And I will.
What does it all mean?
Well, I've decided to give myself up. I'm going back, Jenny. Clear myself. Clear my name.
What happens to us? I love you, whoever you are. I'm going with you.
No, you mustn't. Please, Jenny, I mean, it's painful as it is.
But what if... You said you were innocent.
I was weak then. I was a coward. I couldn't have fought the law, even though they were wrong. But it's different now. I have something to fight for. And that's exactly what I plan to do. It was only 2 hours by air back to the city where I'd lived most of my life, but it seemed an eternity until the plane touched down at the airport. The moment I stepped under the ground, a feeling of guilt returned. Hundreds of people in that city knew me by sight. And if I was picked up before I had the chance to turn myself in, it would be impossible to prove I came back to give myself up. Voluntarily, that is.
A taxi, mister?
Yes.
Where to?
By the county offices.
Right.
Driver, would you happen to know, is Lloyd Mercer still the district attorney?
Not since the election last month. We got a new one, named Jameson.
Oh, I see. Then Mercer won a second term and was defeated this year.
Nope. Mercer didn't run for DA this year. Way I hear it, Jameson's his boy. Mercer ran for Superior Court.
Judge? Judge Mercer?
Yeah, another landslide. They're saying he'll run for governor next time. That Mercer's got one smooth machine.
Yeah. Well, he's the one I want to see.
Well, that'll be the courthouse.
Good afternoon, Judge Mercer's chambers. Just a moment, please. Your Honor, there's a Mr. Alan Bledsoe calling. On line one, sir. Yes, sir. Can I help you?
Yes, I'd like to see Judge Mercer, please.
Your name, please?
Brooks. Carl Brooks.
I'm afraid you'll have to make an appointment, Mr. Brooks. Would tomorrow afternoon be satisfactory?
Look, I have to see him right away.
The judge is a very busy man.
Could you please tell him I'm here?
All right, I'll ring in, but... Judge, there's a Mr. Brooks out here, and he insists... Yes, Carl Brooks. Yes, sir. He said to go right in, Mr. Brooks.
Carl, how are you? Well, don't just stand there. Sit down. Tell me, how have you been? What have you been doing? What brings you back to our fair city?
I don't understand. I mean, I came back to give myself up.
Give yourself? Oh, well, you mean the Henley murder?
Of course.
Oh, that's marvelous. You mean you've been thinking all these years, what is it now, almost five? You've been worried, hiding? Carl, there's no charge against you.
No charge? But I read in the paper. I mean, the day after it happened that I was the prime suspect.
You were, for a couple of hours. It was open and shut, Carl. The murderer was apprehended, tried, convicted, and executed. We still had the death penalty done.
You mean all this time, the running, the changing my name, giving up my law career, living with fear that at any time, for nothing? I mean, it was all for nothing?
I am sorry, Carl, but if you hadn't run...
I'm free? You mean I'm free?
As the proverbial bird, Carl. But I hope this doesn't mean you're going to fly away before we've had a chance to have dinner together, or at least a drink.
Look, can I make a phone call first?
You're welcome to use my phone.
No, thank you. No, it's long distance and personal. I've got a question to spring on a young lady.
My premature congratulations. A local girl?
No, California. Maybe it all turned out for the best. I mean, if I hadn't left, I never would have met Jenny.
But you won't leave town without saying goodbye.
Judge, you have my solemn oath.
You're sure, darling? Absolutely sure?
That's what the man said. Look, I'll be on my way now, but there just isn't a plane leaving for the coast until tomorrow.
I'll come there if you like.
No. Don't you dare. I'm coming home for life.
Oh, Carl. I have to get used to calling you Carl.
Look, I'm going to check into a hotel, and then I'll pick up some of my things and, well, maybe have a drink with Mercer or whoever before I leave.
Mrs. Carl Brooks. Jennifer Brooks. I like the sound of it.
Hey, you're not listening.
Oh, yes, I am. You're coming home.
See you tomorrow, love. Goodbye.
Bye.
Carl? Is that Carl Brooks?
Hugo! Wow, you look great. I mean, it's really been a long time. You still with the Chronicle? How the hell are you?
Can't complain. Up till now. What happened? Mercer bring you back to run his next campaign?
Hugo.
I wasn't notified of any high school class reunion.
Hugo, come on now. Why are you riding me?
How'd you like the trial?
Oh, believe it or not, today's the first I've heard of it. I mean, all along, I thought that you know...
You're a long time late.
Late? For what?
Barry Wilson, for one.
Barry? What about him? I mean, I was just going to call him.
I'm afraid they don't have phone service where Barry is.
Where is he?
You don't know? You really don't know?
No.
Barry was executed for Henley's murder.
Barry? Well, that's impossible.
Was it?
But, no, that's not possible. I mean, I saw him. I mean, he was just arriving at the hotel... After Henley was dead.
That's what Barry kept saying, that he had a perfect alibi. You.
But the trial, Hugo. He was convicted.
Because you were running, because you weren't here to testify for him. He kept saying, Carl will come back and prove I'm innocent. But Carl was running to save his own skin. And Mercer needed a quick arrest to assure his re-election as DA. Barry was the perfect pigeon.
But a jury doesn't convict without. I mean, they must have had some evidence.
You keep telling yourself that if it's any comfort. Sure, Mercer built up a case and made it stick because Barry's only witness couldn't be found.
But you see, I thought I was the one they were looking for.
If you were innocent, why'd you run? Or maybe you weren't. You said yourself Barry couldn't have done it.
Barry's dead? Wow. What about Ellen and their little girl?
Well, they're doing fine. Just fine. Ellen's adjusted to life as a widow. And the kids at school make it wonderful for little Katie. Oh, but don't let it bother you, Carl. Obviously, it hasn't so far. Send him a card after you leave. Goodbye, Carl. Have a wonderful life.
Thank you.
this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, Dead Man's Tale. I'm Rod Serling, and this is the Zero Hour. Brooks was a man in the wrong place at the wrong time. He arrived at a downtown hotel, per instructions, to pick up a locked attaché case for his boss, District Attorney Lloyd Mercer, only to find an empty case and a dead man. Seen in the room and falsely accused, Carl Brooks, a man in a panic, chose to run. 4 years later, in a town far away, this same man, haunted by the past and the lie his new life had become, made still another choice: to return and face whatever the charge, whatever the consequences. He returned to find all charges against him dropped. The case was history. But for Carl Brooks, the consequences were immense. His closest friend had been judged guilty and executed. The only man who could have saved him was absent from the trial. That man had run. That man was Carl Brooks. Our story, Dead Man's Tale, resumes after this message.
Yuga left me standing in the hotel lobby like I was nailed to the floor. Barry Wilson and I had been friends since before I could remember. We'd done everything together, school, baseball. I even introduced him to Ellen. Now, Barry was dead. Executed by the state for a crime he did not commit. And there was nothing I could do to bring him back. I had returned to my hometown for a purpose, to clear myself of any guilt. I never dreamt how terribly guilty I really was.
I understand, Carl. I understand how awful you must feel. But what can you do?
I'm not sure, Jenny. I only know there's Ellen and her little girl. And they don't pay widow's benefits to the wife of a man convicted of a capital crime. I've got to do something for them I should have done 4 years ago. Prove Barry's innocence. It's the least I can do.
All right, but Carl, you sound as if you feel guilty.
I am.
No, you're not. You didn't kill anybody.
Neither did Barry.
Oh, Carl, don't do this to yourself. What happened is unfair, and I'm not asking you to do nothing about righting a wrong, but...
Jenny, please, just give me a little time. I mean, what I said before still goes. This is something I have to do before we can have a decent life together.
Does that mean you want me to stay here in Coulter?
For now, yes. Do you understand why?
I'm trying to. All any of us can do is try. Goodbye, darling.
Goodbye, darling. I didn't know exactly how or where to start. From the beginning seemed like the logical place. I checked into the Delta Hotel, and then I arranged to meet Lloyd Mercer at the Skylight Lounge.
Well, Carl, what's it going to be? Dinner or just a quick drink?
I've canceled my reservation.
Oh? I thought you had a young lady breathlessly awaiting your return.
Well, that was before I found out what happened to Barry Wilson.
I hope to spare you that. Terribly unfortunate, unpleasant all around. But what's it got to do with your changing your plans?
Barry was innocent.
He had a jury trial, Carl. He was convicted.
But who prosecuted the case?
It was my job. Not a happy one under the circumstances, but I had no choice but to prosecute without fear or favor.
Well, did he tell you I saw him at the Delta Hotel, that he was arriving 5 minutes after I found the body?
So he claimed.
Well, it's true.
Well, since we couldn't find you, I weighed the possibility that it might have been true.
You didn't believe him?
It gave me pause. But then I realized he could have come back to the hotel after killing Henley so that you could see him just arriving to be his alibi if he needed one. As matters developed, I'm certain that that was the case.
But he shouted to me as I was running for a taxi that you had asked him to meet me there.
Yes, he made that allegation at the trial. Untrue, of course. Why would I do that?
I don't know. All I heard him say was that the chief sent him.
Not much of a defense.
I guess not. Just one man's word against another.
Don't be petty, Carl. It doesn't suit you.
Look, was there any hard evidence against Barry?
I could let you have the transcript if you like. But briefly, motive. He was rather deeply in debt. An opportunity? He obviously listened on the inner office intercom to my instructions to you about picking up the attaché case from Henley. We both know that he left the office considerably ahead of you.
Yes, but he was going home. I mean, Judge, you Barry.
Naturally, he claimed that he'd never heard of Henley, so we'll never know.
Were there any fingerprints?
Only yours and Henley's. A murderer would have been more careful. Barry couldn't account for his movements just prior to or during the time of the murder. He had $500 in cash he couldn't explain, and then the bald-faced lie about my sending him to the hotel.
Wasn't there anything else?
It's all in the transcript, if you're that interested. But why are we retrying the case now, Carl?
Your Honor, I don't think Barry Wilson killed Robert Henley.
Really? Well, perhaps you should have been public defender, champion of the law.
Look, I'm serious, Judge. I mean, let's assume Barry did listen in.
A fair assumption.
Maybe he didn't go straight home.
And went instead to the Delta Hotel.
Or he could have gone almost anywhere. Why not here, for a cocktail?
Because he went straight to the Delta Hotel, room 515, and murdered Robert Henley.
But why? I mean,
motive, Carl,
no reason
motive.
To...
The man needed money.
No motive, Judge. I mean, it was documents I was sent there for. There was never any mention of money.
I suggest you read the transcript.
Look, was there any money? I was never clear on that.
None that was ever recovered, nor were the documents, for that matter. Could have cost me the election. Barry was guilty. Take my word for it. You can go back to your new life with a clear conscience. It was good seeing you again, Carl.
I see. Case dismissed.
Goodbye, Carl.
I was just leaving. Thanks for your time, Your Honor. Lloyd Mercer had offered little in the way of information about the trial. That was to be expected. Motive. That was the fatal flaw in the case for the prosecution. A man was murdered for something he was carrying in an attaché case. Documents or money or both. And in 4 years, there had been no trace of either. Barry was railroaded. But by whom? And had that been the master plan from the beginning? More likely, Barry was merely a convenient second choice. A substitute for me. I had terribly mixed emotions about my next move. I had to talk to Ellen Wilson, Barry's widow. She had been Ellen Upshaw when we'd first met, the prettiest girl in the whole junior class. We went together almost until graduation, quite the campus couple we were. Then one day, after a football game, I introduced her to the star halfback. That was Barry Wilson. They were married the week after commencement. 2 years later, Katie was born. I took a taxi to the modest two-bedroom tract home the Wilsons had bought the year before Barry's execution. It was just as I'd remembered it, only the lawn was now overgrown with weeds. Up close, I could see the paint was peeling, and one of the windows had been broken and been repaired with only cardboard and a tape. It wasn't the same. Nothing was.
Don't believe it.
Hello, Ellen.
What do you want here?
Can we talk?
Now? 4 years later, you want to talk?
Ellen, it's important. May I come in?
All right.
Thank you.
I have nothing to say to you. You don't mind if I stand?
I won't be long.
Why, Carl? Why did you come back? Why now? Why ever? You're too late. Barry's dead.
I know. Hugo Brunel told me about it. I just didn't know.
You didn't know? The biggest, most sensational trial in the history of the state? You say you didn't know?
Well, that's the truth.
Keep your voice down. The baby's asleep.
Katie?
Yes, Katie. It wasn't time for another, damn you. She's really not a baby anymore.
No, she must be 8 years old.
Yes. And her father's been dead half her life.
Don't you think I know that? Don't you know it's been eating up my insides just to think about it? Ellen, I came back to prove I didn't kill that man.
Didn't you?
Well, if I had, would I have come back at all?
Barry didn't kill him, Carl. And he can't come back.
I know. I know.
Now, go away. Leave us alone.
Not until I prove Barry was innocent.
What good would that do now? Look at me. Take a good look. These aren't laugh lines around my eyes. It's anguish. You want to go to school with Katie? She could show you to the class and tell them who you are.
Ellen, I'm not asking for forgiveness. I just want to know what really happened. I've got to start somewhere. Did Barry say anything to you about money?
Money?
I mean, did he ever hear of a...
Money? You want to know about money? Wait right here. Let me show you something, mister. Go back to bed, honey. Mommy will be right in. Here. Take a look at that.
Cashier's check for $100.
I get one every month, without fail.
Who sends it?
I don't know. Who makes deposits into my bank account? Every time my balance falls below $50, another $50 is deposited automatically and anonymously.
Haven't you tried to find out?
Oh, yes. At first. And got nowhere. Then I thought, what if asking too many questions should shut it off? How would I pay all the extras the little money I was earning didn't cover? Then I lost my job. Now it's 2 days' work here, an afternoon there. Nothing for weeks on end.
Ellen, this means that somebody... I mean, this is obviously conscience money.
Blood money. And who pays Dr. Irwin for me? 2 operations in the past 3 years. Hospital bills. Katie's tonsils.
Ellen, I think there's a real chance that I can clear Barry's name.
You mean you can stir things up? Get it all in the newspapers and on television again. Ruin what little we have left.
But if I could force them to reopen the case...
And if they don't find the guilty party...
Well, I have to do something.
Don't you think you've done enough? Leave it alone. Oh, Carl, I thought I knew you so well. I never really knew you at all. Go. Go back where you came from. Leave us alone.
Ellen was right, of course, about what would happen if I succeeded in bringing it all to public attention again. On the other hand, if I could gather information, get some answers of my own, and then come forward with the facts, I might accomplish a great deal for Ellen and Katie, at least in terms of security. But how much of it would be for her, and how much for myself, to soothe my own conscience? 3 unsolved M's, money, motive, and murder. According to the learned judge, Barry was in debt. That was something I hadn't known and didn't think it proper to ask Ellen about. Gambling is illegal in the state, but everyone knows it goes on, appropriately disguised. I took a taxi back to town to pay a visit to just such an establishment, and an old acquaintance I had last seen at the Hotel Delta sprawled on the floor. If anybody would know about money, he would.
Well, there it is, just up ahead, the one with all the lights flashing.
Well, that's where I want to go.
You sure? The Ferris wheel's the most expensive nice spot in town. I mean, there's better places to eat and a lot cheaper, too.
Well, you see, I'm not hungry.
I get it. Back room, huh?
Yeah, you got it.
Well, that's the luck, buddy. You'll need it back there. You'd be better off eating, if you know what I mean.
I know what you mean. Keep it.
Hey, thanks.
Good evening, sir. Do you have a reservation?
I want to ride on the merry-go-round.
Your name, sir?
Wilson.
A gentleman who ride the merry-go-round. Mr. Wilson.
Barry Wilson.
Barry Wilson. As you wish, sir. Down the hall. This key opens the door on the right.
Thank you.
Always the lemon, isn't it? You can do better at craps or roulette.
I'm not really a gambling man, Cyrus.
Oh, I thought you were.
Can we talk in private?
My office private enough?
Fine.
You've changed your name, I see.
Yeah, several times. You don't seem surprised to see me.
Oh, I've been expecting you.
Mercer called you.
Let's just say I heard that Carl Brooks was back in town. I figured you might drop in for a ginger ale.
No, no, it would be watered down.
Still cute, huh, Brooks? Look, you got lucky once. I don't take kindly to people punching me out. My jaw was real tender for a while. Couldn't eat steak for a week. You know, I could call in a few of my boys and have them punch you out. Or I could do it myself.
What's stopping you?
Maybe I've mellowed.
Maybe you'd just as soon I left town, quietly.
Like I said, Brooks, you got lucky once. Now, don't push it.
You mind if I sit down?
No, be my guest. But don't get too comfortable. You'll be leaving soon.
You know, you sure have a nice place here, Farris. You must really rake it in.
All right, cute guy. What's on your mind?
Barry Wilson.
What about him?
I understand he used to ride the merry-go-round and couldn't pay for the tickets.
Well, you can't collect from a dead man.
I seem to recall you saying one time how you like to keep an eye on your investments. By the way, whatever happened to all the money?
What money?
The $150,000 Henley was killed for.
Keep dreaming, Brooks. That was documents the stiff had on him.
Do you have any idea who's sending Ellen Wilson $100 documents every month?
I think it's about time you cashed in your chips, punk. A smart gambler quits when the odds are against him.
You know, Farris, if I didn't know you to be a solid citizen, I'd say that sounded like a threat.
Oh, no threat. A promise.
Mm-hmm. Don't bother to get up. I can find my way out. Farris was lying. Of that I was sure. There was money, all right. The night of the murder, Farris had been in the room the same time I was, but I didn't hear him come in. He could have killed Henley, stolen the money, and waited for me to arrive. Of course, a hired killer was a possibility. Joe Farris was certainly not one to stick his own neck out, like I was doing. But what really puzzled me was the money Ellen was getting. I couldn't see Farris giving money away for any reason, and Lloyd Mercer? Well, I was sure convinced he had no conscience at all. I had nothing to go on but a hunch, and I needed help. I headed straight for the red and white neon lights of the Chronicle building. The heavy glass doors were locked. I could see a uniformed guard inside. Yes, is Hugo Brownell working tonight?
Yeah, but not here. He's out on a story somewhere.
Well, is there any way I can get in touch with him? I mean, it's very important.
I'll see him when he comes back. Mm.
Well, would you have him call me at the Delta Hotel? The name is Brooks. It doesn't matter how late, just so he calls. Would you tell him that?
Brooks, Delta Hotel, right?
Right. I took a sandwich with me up to the room at the hotel so I wouldn't miss Hugo's call. I ate slowly to make the time go faster. Then thoughts of Jenny swept over me like a veil of stardust, and I began to wonder if what I was doing was really worth it. Why was I compelled to be where I was, away from her? It was all so frustrating and becoming dangerous. Yuga had to have returned by now. I was pretty sure he had gotten the message, and I had gotten his. If it's help you want, count me out. Carl Brooks, you're on your own.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, Dead Man's Tale. I'm Rod Serling, and this is the Zero Hour.
Today's episode brought to you in part by Contact and the Ford Motor Company. This is the Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
You have been listening to The Zero Hour, a presentation of the Mutual Broadcasting System in association with Hollywood Radio Theater, heard every weekday at this time. Rod Serling is your host. Zero Hour is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis. The Hollywood Radio Theater theme was played by Ferranti and Teicher and is now available on United Artists Records and Tapes. Hugh Douglas speaking. Tune in tomorrow and once again,
rest your eyes and listen here
to The Zero Hour.
This is the Mutual Radio Network.